Good afternoon and welcome to Frontline Live. You find us here at Manchester Goals, where we're here for the Partnership Trophy. Run for the last 10 years by the Salvation Army's Homeless Services Unit, it's an opportunity for residents, staff and even some managers to play the beautiful game. We're going to have guests, residents, staff, lots of people talking to us about this wonderful opportunity to see the person, not the label. Our first guest this afternoon is Major Hilary Watson. Major Hilary, tell me what your job is, because it's quite a complicated title.
Full title is Assistant Territorial Director of Homeless Services Unit, open bracket South, close bracket.
Quite a mouthful. But it's a very exciting role that you have, because you're working with a fantastic team of people at the Salvation Army, doing some of the work that we've been doing in the Salvation Army for over 150 years. But what's this about, the Partnership Trophy?
Well, the Partnership Trophy, in essence, it's a five-a-side football tournament. Simple as that. We have Lifehouses across the UK, and they're all invited to send a five-a-side team to Manchester on a particular day. It happens to be today. to have a knockout tournament to have a trophy at the end of it.
How did it come about?
Well, a number of years ago, we were looking for an event that could be bringing people together, to helping individual Lifehouses realise they're part of a bigger organisation, and that there's other people in the same situation. And we wanted it to be something that everybody could be part of. And in a football tournament, there's lots of things you can do. You can play, you can support, you can mend broken legs, you can do labels, you can make kit, you can wash kit, and so everyone could get involved. So we settled on a five-a-side tournament, started in Birmingham, but we're now in Manchester, and it's a really great day.
Now, you'll notice that there's not anyone actually currently playing football, and that's because they're all having a brilliant time with a Q&A with one of the legends in the football game. So we're letting them do that. They'll be back later, and you'll see some footage of that as well. But it's a special anniversary this year, isn't it?
It's our 10th anniversary. Unfortunately, we couldn't meet last year because of the pandemic, but we were determined this year to do what we could to get this tournament up and running again. So we've reduced numbers because of the COVID situation, but we've got, we asked 16 teams to meet together to be part of a knockout tournament. We have group stages, so they all get several games, going to the knockout stages this afternoon. And yeah, it's our 10th anniversary. It's really great.
It's 10 o'clock and teams are arriving here in Manchester from all over the UK, ready to play some football. This is the 10th Salvation Army Partnership Trophy. And in case you missed it, the Partnership Trophy is the Salvation Army's very own annual five-a-side football tournament. It's aimed specifically at people who've experienced homelessness. And today we're expecting 15 teams from Salvation Army Lifehouses up and down the UK. So I'm here today with some of our brilliant players, and I'm here with Connor. Connor, where have you come from today?
Wallace Campsie in Glasgow.
Oh, fantastic. So we've got the Scottish, are you the only Scottish team
today? I think we are the only Scottish team. I think there might be another one, I'm not too sure yet. I've not met many teams yet.
So you're doing it for Scotland?
Yeah, we're doing it for Glasgow.
Is it your first time doing this?
Yeah, we went to a Glasgow tournament not long ago, and this was the first time Wallace had been invited to a major tournament, so they were proud of it. So.
Fantastic. Aye. What does it mean to you having this opportunity to come and do something like this?
Just to prove, like when you're homeless, and there's still an answer to it and there's stuff you can do about it, so no point in getting your hopes in.
Yeah. And it kind of gives you hope for the future, something to focus on.
Yeah, it gives you something to look forward to, major tournaments and whatever else we can do with the homeless team, to show that there's answers to everything.
Yeah. I'm here now with Billy. Billy, where have you come from today?
Birmingham.
Birmingham, fantastic. And is this your first time doing this tournament?
It is, yeah.
Why do you think football's important for us? Why is sport important for us?
It keeps you fit and healthy, it helps with mental health. Which I have, so I need to do this to keep my head straight.
Yeah. Jordan, where have you come from today?
Blackburn, Salvation Army. It's Bromlin, I'm sure it's Bromlin House. Oh God, I don't even know where I live. It's in a great start, is it?
That's all right. So you've come from there, is this your first time doing the tournament?
Yeah, it is, yeah. First time doing something like this, like football kind of wise, but not activity wise. I set up some stuff as well within there, like, and help them out quite a lot.
Fantastic.
Now I've got a house now and I'm out of there now, semi out of there.
Wow.
So I want to go back on volunteering to come back, and yeah, but they are important, these games, like, it brings people together.
Yeah.
Makes them aware that not everyone is you know, when you're homeless and stuff, you feel like you're on your own, you feel like you've got nobody. But this place makes you feel like you're not on your own and you've got somebody, doesn't it, really? Like you get a bit of a more of a lease on life. It makes you feel better. They go home and they feel better as well. Yeah. They're talking about it, get some talking, yeah. Get some, you know. So, yeah, it is, yeah, really good.
The Salvation Army helps its residents find housing and employment and provides support so that they can tackle addictions and increase their well-being. Staff and volunteers also encourage people to exercise and take part in team sports because they're a great way of boosting mental and physical health, so the partnership trophy fits right in. We're all looking forward to a great day, celebrating what service users have overcome and achieved to be here today, and the fact it's brought everyone together.
And of course, at the end of the day, the winning team get to take home this beautiful trophy. But for now, it's all to play for. Fantastic to hear those stories of some of our arrivals. I particularly loved what Jordan had to say. I think I might have a shot on the ladies' team next year. Hillary, what do you think? You're joining me?
Yeah, I'm
wonderful. And we also have Miracle with us, one of our service managers. Wonderful to have you with as well. We'll come to you in just a little bit, if that's all right.
That's
fine. But Hillary, just a few more questions. Thinking about, we heard there a little bit about the impact of coming together of sport on mental health and wellbeing. Is that something that the Homeless Services Unit is very interested in?
Absolutely. Lifehouses aren't just a place where we provide accommodation. And within our Salvation Army Lifehouses, and we call them lifehouses rather than hostels, because it's about life and life in all its fullness. So it is about mental health, it's about social skills, it's about learning to be part of community. Mm. So football actually helps bring all that about, because they're working together, so they have to communicate together, they have to be part of a team, they feel that sense of belonging, and it's actually great for physical and mental health.
Yeah. The theme that we're using is see the person, not the label. What's that about?
Too often people talk about the homeless and have a fixed image in their head about a homeless person. But actually we're saying, let's not call somebody homeless. Let's see the person. Who's behind that label? And if you got to know any of these, you'd see that they've got fabulous stories. They're all individuals. And, you know, we have people who've had very, very successful careers, but because of circumstances have found themselves homeless. We've got some people who have struggled with life and maybe as a young person got thrown out by their parents and have had to cope with life on their own ever since. Mm. But they're all very different. But they've all got a story to tell, and they're all worth working with and bringing to you know, a better life.
Absolutely. Thank you, Hillary. Miracle, we're going to hear a little bit about you in just a moment. But first of all, we're going to see you in action as you've been doing some prep for today with Cambria House and with Malachi Place.
Salvation Army football teams up and down the UK have been training for this year's partnership trophy. For the staff, volunteers and residents of Cambria Lifehouse in central London, today is no exception.
Every Wednesday, 4 o'clock to 5 o'clock, we come out here, rain or shine, and just make sure we do some work on the ball and also exercising ourselves as well.
Okay, so because they're the ones coming to see us, let's let them pass the ball.
All right, go!
Today, the stakes are a little bit higher, as Cambria House are playing a practice match against some local rivals, Malachi Place from Ilford.
Yeah, I think it just bonds us together, and you know, we're from all walks of life, and it's interesting, and it's good.
Well, just exercise every day for mental health is it's good for the brain. And I like to play football, I love. With a good team, with a good people, I enjoy, it's so nice.
That's one key aspect here. It's what it does generally for the well-being of the individual and can give you the motivation and sometimes the kick that you need to get back on track.
We have a lot of support workers. They look after us. They're nice people. Yeah. They help me for housing, food. They help me for rent, for a lot of things. I like them. I love them. Yeah.
I think Cambria House, as a life house,
does that in terms of getting somebody to move from point A to B and getting them back on track in terms of pursuing their goals and visions.
And after weeks of training, what are the chances that Cambria House win this year's partnership trophy?
It's obvious. We're coming back with the cup. We're winning the trophy. I'm very hopeful, very positive. I just hope others let us win.
And hopefully now you can see some of the footballers coming back onto pitch. They've had a nice break, they're limbering back up, and hopefully you can see them getting ready for the next couple of rounds. It's going pretty well so far. I think that's very, very fair to say. Miracle, one of our service managers. Great to see you in that last little VT. Loving all of the preparation. How's it going so far?
I think we're doing extremely badly well, I must say. We haven't won a lot of games, but I think it's not really about winning the games. It's more about the participation. It's more about the community and just coming together. It does make a whole lot of difference. So I think we're here. That's what's important. And we're enjoying what's going on. So.
Absolutely. Oh, fantastic. What does an event like this mean to some of your residents?
Well-being. Coming out like we have today is great. I had one of the residents very excited about, you know, just coming out to play, meeting others, getting to meet others from other live houses. It's therapeutic. It's great for the mental well-being and also our physical well-being.
Yeah.
Coming to exercise. I'm tired. I'm knackered at the moment, but I'm getting there. It's been great being here.
And of course, you haven't just been, you know, having support from the service managers and all the different people from the Salvation Army. You've also had some special guests here today, I understand. Would that be right?
Wow, I thought Paul was spot on.
So we have
Paul Merson.
Paul Merson,
yeah,
football
Paul Merson.
Legend. Now, I'm married to an Arsenal fan who was very excited about that.
Yeah, I think what was great about him was how real he was.
Right.
You know, very often we look at celebrities and think life is so smooth for them. And so it's good to see someone be real and speak about challenges in life. It makes you identify with the individual and know that the struggles you may be going through is not just about you.
Yeah.
It's just what how life can be at times. And I thought that's why I really enjoyed what Paul spoke about today. He was authentic, he was real. I give my thumbs up to him.
Well, let's go and see that wonderful football legend, Paul Merson. So I'm joined today by a very special guest, football legend, now football pundit, Paul Merson. Thank you so much for being
Pleasure.
With us.
Pleasure. Thank
here.
You for having me. Thank you.
So this is something that you are kind of passionate about, coming along and supporting these kind of groups. Why are you here today?
Yeah, very much so. I mean, growing up as a kid, I mean, it was the one thing where I lived. There was a massive Salvation Army. It's always stuck in my head, the shield and, you know, and the band and everything. But it's not just that. It's a way to help, you know, homeless people and people who need help, you know, and that's the reason why. And I think something like today brings people together. It brings, you know, it's, you know, in my recovery, it's like in GA and AA, being around people, being in the same, and to not know you're not alone.
Yeah.
And I think that's the most important thing. And I think football's a big thing to bring people together. And that's the reason. It's the reason is for that. And the great work that the Salvation Army do, I really believe in it.
One of our main mottos for this whole kind of department is about seeing people, not labels.
Yeah.
So why do you think this is important for enabling people that are homeless or staying in our lifehouses? How does it help them find value? How does sport help you find value?
I think it gives you something for mental health, for physicality, to do something, you know, they're not, because when you get down, you know, you can get depression. It's easy just to sit around and fall into yourself. I mean, sport brings you out of that. I've just got it 5 minutes ago, and you can hear everybody shouting and calling for the ball, you know, and everybody's involved, and that's what you want. And the most important thing with mental illness is talking. It's talking. You know, when you're on your own, that's when it's not good. When you're around people and you're talking and you realise you're not alone, it's just a massive plus, and that's why I'm here today. That's you know, and shouldn't be labelled. You know, the people, you know, unfortunate people have, you know, along the way, what's happening in their lives is, you know, you've got to say for the grace of God. And that's, you know, and, you know, I think I have problems. You know, you come and you see people here and, you know, I should be grateful.
You've been really open in the past about your addiction and about your recovery.
Yeah.
How have the last 18 months been for you?
Up and down. I was fortunate, you know what? I was fortunate to have a garden. I've got three little kids and I had a garden, you know, and it was not at the time. I'm not going to lie. But since we come out of lockdown and you drive past massive apartment flats and all that, and you think, oh God, if you had three kids sitting in that little apartment, and I think then it was like, it was a big realization. I relapsed in lockdown. I turned to gambling again. I got addicted to the news, got addicted to it, and started sitting down at 5 o'clock watching Boris Johnson, and it played games. You know, I got massive anxiety. My anxiety went through the roof. I didn't see a way out. I didn't see it was going to be a way out of this. And I went and gambled everything away, you know, or whatever we had, my family. So it was hard, but at the time, for a reason, you know, I'm well today. And if it wasn't for that, would I be well today? I'm not sure.
The Salvation Army is all about offering hope. Mm. What are your thoughts about what the Salvation Army is trying to do here today?
I think that's it. I think it's hope. It is hope. I mean, me personally, you know, I'm not a politician, I'm not an MP or anything, but I think it's one of the biggest criminal things in the world that someone could be homeless in a country where we're not a third world country. We're a wealthy company up there, we're the best of them. And for the size of our country, we're probably one of the wealthiest countries in the world, if you went to size. And I just think when someone is sleeping on the streets, it's criminal, absolutely criminal.
Paul, I can't tell you how much it's going to mean to these guys and girls that you've shown up today. I'm going to let you go and watch and cheer them on and see some cracking football.
Thank you.
Paul Merson,
thank
everybody.
You very much. Thank you.
Paul Merson there, what an absolute legend. I could have talked to him for hours, but I really wanted him to get to see the players because that's what he was here to do. And I've got to tell you, we spent loads of time, didn't he, with all of the different players, cheering them on, chatting, getting the odd selfie in there as well, I noticed. And it was fantastic to see him doing that. But we would really love some more questions from you guys. If you want to know more, if you want to know about Paul Merson, if you want to know about what it means to work for the Salvation Army, if you want to hear from Chris, who's our resident, he might be able to tell you what it's like to live in a life house and what it's like to help others and to pay it forward. What is it you want to know? Send us your question on the live chat. That will really help us out. But before we do that, we're going to spend a bit of time talking to Chris, who, as I said, is a resident in one of our life houses. He's our friend. We've known him for a while. And last year, we went to visit. Here's what happened.
I had a lot of addiction issues. About 11-year-old, I was taking the LSD. I was 16 when my mum put me out of the house. I was smashing up my room because I was taking like temazepam and all that. The past 30 years have been just kind of chaotic. Me jumping from one drug to another drug. And then that was when I first got introduced with the Salvation Army through in Glasgow and leading me on to a better life.
Now, Chris, we were with you a year ago. It doesn't feel like it was all that long ago, actually. The most important question that I need to ask you is, how is your team doing?
Absolutely fantastic.
Yay!
We've won three, drawn one, and lost one. So we're doing great. But as Miracle said, it's just about people coming together. I'm going to have a laugh. It's about people coming to vibe. For people with mental health issues and all that coming out, you're maybe not used to socialising as much or feel the social anxiety. But you're out there and you're meeting a nice bunch of guys, it's really kind of really good.
How did you get to this place? Tell us your story.
It's hard. It's, for me, it was like addiction and homelessness. And what it actually boils down to is that I've never had any self-worth. I've always felt like I didn't fit in. So I thought I'd take drugs and alcohol to kind of mask that. And in the short term, it might be okay. But in the long term, you end up with housing issues. You end up, as I did, on the streets. And then you're kind of sleeping during the day and whatever to keep yourself safe. Mm. It's a difficult road, and everyone's kind of everyone's on their own sort of journey. But I find there's a lot of support out there, networks out there, and it's something I've learned. It's if you engage with them, then you start to move forward in your life, and things, it takes longer. As addicts, we think instant gratification, it has to be overnight. But when you actually realise it's going to take me a bit of time, and you start working with people, and you see, all, like I said, the decent guys, bunch of people and all that, you realise that the just rewards that you get are stuff like this is much better than sitting drugged out my nut anyway.
Yeah. What are your hopes for your future?
My hopes for my future is just to keep progressing forward. Going forward, not kind of thinking about the past, not living in the past. And more so actually try to live in the present, because I think a lot of us can live in the past or live in the future. I'm a safety one of my workers. I'm the world's best at saying I'm going to, but then I'm the world's worst at going, but what if? And then as an addict, I talk myself out of it. And it's so easy to sink back into the concrete. You might have a flat, but it's so easy to sink back into that. Be lonely, and because you don't want to, you're too humble, you don't want to bother people, you feel like you're a hindrance. So it's so easy to sink back into that. But if you get a good bunch of guys around you, which I have had through the Salvation Army and Housing First, that have been there for me and kind of go, well, come on, we'll get you to this, we'll get you to that, and you get kind of coming to tournaments like this, and that's brilliant. You know? So.
What would you say to somebody who is maybe at home watching or knows somebody who is struggling with addiction and feels that there is no hope for them and no help for them? What would you say?
There is loads of help out there. I know that like, obviously we're not a third world country now, but there is a lot of help out there. But as much as you might think there isn't help out there, there is. And if you just engage with it, I'm living proof that if you don't engage with it, it doesn't work. And you end up just still in the same position. But then once you start to engage with it, things get better, and you will see that the support networks are out there. And it's not just like the Salvation Army, there's loads of different charities that are working through mental health, addiction, homelessness, to grasp a hold of it and make sure that people aren't left kind of forgotten about on the streets there, because then they're just classed as another number. So the people that are watching at home, I would say just engage. Try and get someone to engage with the services, and then they will see themselves that it starts to move forward and things will start to get better for them.
Yeah, Chris, you're such an inspiration. I'm really hoping that your team keep doing marvellously well. I'm not at all biased, but the fact that being a Moya. I've been shouting on the sidelines and trying not to be partisan, but it's really difficult, I've got to tell you. A couple of wider questions. Chris really hits on some important things for both of you, I think, but Hilary in particular. The Salvation Army's work isn't just about Lifehouses, but how do you offer that hope? How do you do all those things? How do we do that?
It's really working with each individual and coming alongside them and listening to their story and being with them where they are and just giving them the small steps to take to start on that journey. And we need to listen to everyone. There's no two journeys the same, no two stories the same. So to listen to people, to give them that chance to feel that they are in a trusting relationship, a safe environment, they will start to share their story and believe that there is hope and they can move forward. And that's what it's about. And a miracle in the many years he's been working in this sector will probably have many stories to tell. But it is about working with each individual to give them hope, to deal with whatever their issues are, and nobody is the same. Whether it's addiction, whether it's isolation and loneliness, if it's mental health, whatever it is, it's identifying and helping them come to terms with that and move forward.
Yeah. Miracle, this might be a question for you. If we see someone who is street homeless or tells us that they're currently experiencing homelessness, how should we support them? What could we do?
I making it very particular for me is always about the person first. If you can connect with an individual and get to at least know about them and know about their journey, then it helps you to know what step to take next. But there are various services around that you could actually signpost people to. But I think what is most important is that you connect with the individual, at least know about the story, then
think of how the journey can progress from where they are at the moment.
Yeah.
So it's about the person first.
Fantastic. And Chris, I want to give you the last word on this, because today is all about the residents and about celebrating you and your achievements. A lovely question here is about thinking about people that might be wondering, you know, what's the point? It's all too difficult. What would you say to somebody that's not sure whether they can donate and know that it's going to go to the right place?
Oh, it definitely goes to the right place. There's all the guys that are here are living proof of that they're getting the help and the support, that it's going in the right direction. So anyone that's going to donate, all they are doing is that they're helping guys like me, the boys that are out there, Joe Bloggs, you call them on the street, you're helping them from getting to maybe on the street to that point, kicking out, having a kick about with the guys and all that, and moving forward, and then getting a tenancy and supporting you in your tenancy. So it's the donation goes a lot of way.
Fantastic. We really hope you've enjoyed your time with us today. It's gone so quickly. The games are continuing. The shouting is getting louder. I'm off to join them, and not just to shout for Scotland, I shall have you know. But we really hope you can join with us for our next live, which will be our Christmas edition. Why not share that with your friends and family and keep in touch with us? But thank you so much for joining us today. We want to say a special thank you to Pickfords and to Guardiola Sala for everything that they've done. But thank you for watching, and goodbye.